Bonjour, hola, welcome, and hello to you. This is the live Truthfunders radio show on the Inception Radio Network. My name is Art Webb. I am your host for this hour and a half weekly look at everything that is universal, metaphysical, and essentially good. It's about the light here on Truthfunders Radio, and I am joined, as always, by my wonderfully voluptuous co-host. His name is Mark Schwartz, and
voluptuous.
You know, what other word could there be to describe you than voluptuous? No, I appreciate you making it on time, by the way. You almost didn't make it, so I'm glad that you decided to show up at the right time. The storm is crazy here in Southern California. You got a crazy storm going on up there in San Francisco right now too. It's about time we got hit with some of that.
Yeah, it was insane. It was literally down to the minute. I race into the studio maybe 2 minutes before we went on air. So if you hear me huffing and puffing as I do, that is why. Hopefully that sounded like a huff and puff and not something totally weird and like, you know.
Hufflepuff is that's from the Harry Potter franchise, is it not?
That's Hufflepuff, actually.
Witchcraft.
Yes, going into my nerd index. I also want to thank you, Art, very much for sending me that text for that free Chipotle burrito.
Oh, did you do it?
I did do it.
And, I got a free Chipotle burrito too. I ate it the next day. I was down there immediately collecting on my free burrito.
I went up there. I said, more beans, please. I just kept getting as much as I could in that burrito. That was last night. So
for those of you that missed out, I mean, Chipotle is a national chain, right? Everybody knows about.
I call it Chipotle's because it's like McDonald's.
Right. Okay.
So owned by McDonald's.
No, it's not. That's not true. Chipotle. Yeah, no, true. They had a like a whole food scare with E. coli or some nonsense like that back in, I don't know, a few weeks ago, a month or two ago, whatever. So they closed down every single Chipotle restaurant location between between noon and 3 p.m. or something like that last week on one day. Every location, so they could go over like food health stuff with all of their employees. And for everyone that was going to Chipotle that day for lunch, they said, hey, sorry we missed you. We'll send you this free coupon for a free burrito if you tried to come in that day. And I got wind of it online and I texted it to all my friends and everybody took advantage of the free burrito. So it worked out well.
That's why social media is fantastic.
That's why Reddit is fantastic, because that's where it came from. So I thank Reddit for my free Chipotle experience that I had earlier this week.
Then I thank Reddit as well.
Yeah, no, thank you, Reddit. 888-919-2355 is the telephone number here at the Inception Radio Network. If you'd like to get on live with Mark and I for Truthfunders, it's 888-919-2355. This is a high-energy show for me because it's raining outside, and it doesn't rain here often in Southern California. So when it does, I feel like up and antsy a little bit because it's just like a change in energy outside. You know? So I feel good about it, and I really feel even better about this evening or today's show. I don't know, man. I don't know if you're listening live or if you're listening via the podcast, so I can't time stamp myself. I can't say this evening, even though it is this evening where I am. If you're listening to the podcast, I don't want you to have an effed up experience with the show. I want you to believe that it's live. Maybe if you just tuned in live every Wednesday at 6 p.m. Pacific, 9 p.m. Eastern, then we wouldn't have to go through this every single episode of the show, because we do. 888-919-2355 is the telephone number. I don't mean to yell at you, because we have a really good show today, and I want us to be getting along. So I think we should introduce our guest, because I like him, and I like his name, and I like what he stands for, and we're going to have a very interesting conversation on this particular episode of the program. Now, Mark, there was a rapper a couple weeks or so ago. He caught some fire on the internet. As a matter of fact, the first time I read this was on Reddit as well. He caught some flack on the internet for saying that the Earth is flat. Do you remember this? Did you see this?
I caught the after buzz. Yeah. Hey, and also, so we're going to talk about this for sure. But one of the people, one of the creators, and I'm actually going to ask our guest, Mark Sargent, you know, if he's the creator, that I'm not sure, or if this is sort of a theory. I think he was the one who created this theory. I've heard him as a guest.
Has he been alive for hundreds and thousands of years? Because I think this theory first originated.
Well, I mean, originally, yeah, it started back in the day, and then, you know, we sailed around the world and found out that the world is round. Or
supposedly, we can't prove that, you know, according to a couple people, man. Supposedly, we don't know that, you know. We don't.
Shit. So,
do you think we really went to the moon? Do you think 9/11 was an outside job? Huh?
Oh my God, I'm so excited for you.
You think
right
diamonds
now
are mined
so
in a fair and ethical and moral way? What? Is that what you think? What kind of fucking world are you living in?
Excellent. So, yeah, you know, I heard Mark, if he's still there, hopefully.
I'm here.
After your rants. Thank you. this is art, Mark. So, you know, I heard you on Darkness Radio with Dave Schrader. And, you know, there was a whole bunch of shows that I heard you on. And you've sort of been going through the whirlwind tour of radio shows lately because there has been a lot of stuff in the air and online and in social media and Twitter going on and people talking about flat earth theory. Yeah. And the more it seems like people are talking about it, it seems to have a snowball effect, effect and get bigger and bigger. So Art's going to give you a little introduction so we get the whole gist of who you are and where you're from. And then we're going to jump into you. And I have so many questions for you.
Okay.
So Art, can you give a little bio on Mark?
Yeah, I can. Just give me a moment here.
Okay. Or I guess I should just ask Mark. Mark, can you give us a little bio about yourself?
Sure. Since Art can't find my bio, can you? You don't know where it is.
Hey. Everybody just be quiet. Right? Hot second.
I can cut and paste it somewhere if you want me to put it somewhere.
Throw it in the chat. Okay, here I got it.
You got it?
Sure, yeah. Growing up on South growing up on South Whidbey Island in Washington, Mark Sargent started his career playing computer games professionally in Boulder, Colorado, where weed is now legal. From there, he spent the next 20 years training people in proprietary software. That sounds like a pretty boring job.
It is a pretty boring job.
In 2014, he looked into what is no doubt the most ridiculous conspiracy ever called, quote unquote, flat earth theory. Now, I challenge that, actually. I don't know if it's the most ridiculous conspiracy ever. I think hollow earth theory might be a little bit more ridiculous. But, hey, man, we could go tit for tat. You know, we'll see how it goes.
Yeah.
And through extensive research, discovered that it wasn't so laughable after all. See, I think maybe the hollow earth theory may be a little bit more ridiculous because we'll see. Early in 2015, that is just within the last 3 months, he released a series of YouTube videos called, quote, Flat Earth Clues, which delves into the possibility of our human civilization actually being inside a, perhaps, Truman Show-like enclosed system. Like a big dome.
Yep.
And how he's hidden it from the, how it's been hidden from the public since 1956. Wow, that leads so many questions, especially the fact that, it's only been hidden since 1956. I want to start there, if we could. Why 1956, and why is that so recent?
Because in 1956 – now, and by that I mean it was only that the authority figured it out in 1956. You want to take
okay. So it's – okay.
No. The Flat Earth wasn't created in 1956. It's just that the government found out about it in 1956.
Wow. So there's a bigger organization at hand than our government is what you're saying.
Well, I mean, yeah, whoever built it. Yeah. Yeah, they're probably a little more powerful, I'm guessing.
All right. Well, Mark or Mark 2, I don't know. Mark S. May the
You can call me Mark Sargent, you can call me Sargent. I don't care.
They're both Mark S.
call me Sarge. I don't care. Call me whatever you want.
That's cool. I wish I had that name, Sarge.
No, you don't. Yeah, well, no, like you don't. You don't want that.
I'd like to take it back even further, Mark. I mean, this is – we really are very, very excited to have you on the show. And nice. The people who are listening right now, I know the chat room is going to be crazy with questions.
On the bio to give out his personal email address and phone number. Do we want to leave that on or off the air?
No.
Let's not do that right now.
All right.
Okay, great.
Okay.
We'll save that for later.
Yeah, the chat room's going to get ugly. I almost can promise you that.
So I'm curious, and I know probably every interview that you've done has probably started this way, but I think it's good for the audience to know sort of a little bit about you and how you started getting, you know, you were into computer science and you were training people with software, and somehow you got into this idea of the flat earth theory.
Yeah.
And, you know, how did you go from one to the next? And how did your passion for this sort of start to unravel?
Well, like a lot of people, if you spend any amount of time in computers, you're going to go into, you know, some of the dark corners of the internet, and you know, including the conspiracy sites, and you're going to look at, you know, some conspiracies from time to time. And I was into conspiracies for years, all the garden variety stuff, and I'm not going to name them all because you guys know them all. And I got to the point where I really thought I had seen it all. It's like, okay, I'd heard of it. I'd either researched it or heard of it or discounted it. And then I was glancing around on YouTube the summer of, I don't know, 2014, and saw a video by a German guy that was talking about how the plane routes in the Southern Hemisphere look wrong. Like they're really, really screwed up. And I'm going, okay, all right, I'll take a look at this. And he goes, and it doesn't make any sense unless the globe isn't a globe, that it's actually flat, like we're living in some, you know, like on a flat dinner plate disc. And I was going, that doesn't make any sense. But you know what? I'll try to shoot this thing down. And while I was doing it, I watched a video by another guy in the Flat Earth movement. His name was Matthew Boylan. And he was talking about when he was in his 20s, he was hired out of Canada as a graphic artist for NASA, like a contract graphic artist to do various little things for missions. Nothing sinister or anything like that. But that they had told him during a high-level party that the GPS doesn't work down in Antarctica. And, you know, they're kind of joking about that. And it's like, well, you should send somebody down to check it out. And they can say, well, if you send somebody down that far, they're not coming back. And he's going, why is that? He goes, well, because GPS doesn't work down there. He goes, why? Well, because it's flat. And he didn't get it. He didn't get it either. So I'm listening to this story, and it sounds like a neat little sci-fi movie of the week. And so at that point, I really dug into this thing. And I said, okay, I'm just going to try to debunk this thing. I can knock this thing out in a weekend. It's flat Earth, for God's sakes. There's nothing to it. In fact, anyone who's listening here, please understand where I'm coming from. If you don't laugh at this thing right away, if you don't ridicule it, if you don't roll your eyes and get angry or get agitated, there's probably something wrong with you. Because nobody gets this in a few hours. The people who are listening to the show now, they are not going to completely get it. But it is going to be a seed in their head, like a marble in a paint can. It's not.
That's the thing, man. And I'm telling you, Mark, and I don't mean to interrupt
no,
you.
No, please.
It's like, so we have interviewed scientists on our show, geologists from the USGS. We've talked to all sorts of people, scientific, conspiracy theorists, and it's crazy. When I heard you, I heard you on one radio interview. I think it was Jimmy Church.
Oh, okay.
And then I heard you on Darkness Radio, and then I heard you again on Darkness Radio, and I just kept like the seeds were planted. And first I heard it, and I'm like, this is so ridiculous. This is stupid. And it's not like I've necessarily changed my opinion one way or another, but I think about it now.
Yeah.
And I think about it, and yeah, like the wheels have started churning in my head, and I hate myself.
Well, I will say, just in your initial description there, you know, when somebody says the phrase flat Earth,
yep,
the thing that immediately pops into my mind, the imagery that I immediately see in my mind's eye is a flat, almost square-shaped Earth.
Yeah.
And when you were initially describing it there, and you described it as not necessarily that, but like a pancake disc,
yeah,
now that's starting to make me wonder a little bit further, because now in my mind's eye, I'm seeing like all the photos that we do see from space
on
the planets.
Yeah.
And that is exactly what we're looking at, no matter what angle we look at it from. And we do usually only see it from one of two angles. I mean, there's never – you're right. What I'm saying so far, what I'm saying is I'm thinking about it, and you're right.
No, well, thank you. Thank you. So I was, I tried to debunk this thing from June of 2014 all the way through February of 2015. And I got to the point where I was getting extremely frustrated, and I was more stubborn than most, because for me, there wasn't that much material out there. And I woke up, it was so vivid to me. I woke up in the middle of the night on February 10th, 2015, and I had it. I had flipped at that point, I said, because I woke up as going, wait, how in the world do I know, no play on words there, how do I know it's a globe? How did I figure this out? Where's the evidence coming from that it's a globe? And so I sat down and I started to create the Flat Earth clues. And what Mark was saying earlier, no, I didn't create the Flat Earth theory. The Flat Earth theory is 500 years old. You know, the Flat Earth theory was promoted by Copernicus back in the 1500s. But it's kind of it's been in the background. It's been in religion's back pocket, and it's been out of the public eye for centuries. And what all I did was I when I looked at it, I was going, you know, it's not bad, but it sounds a little staticky. The message just wasn't clear enough. So I kind of created a set of clues. They're real short, and most of them are less than 15 minutes long, and no math is involved in any of them. I said, look, here's why I think the world is not a globe. It's actually flat, and it's an enclosed system like a snow globe, like a planetarium, like a terrarium. And I put the challenge out to the internet. I go, tell me how I'm wrong. Tell me how you know it's a globe. And since then, I've changed it, because now the question is, I say, who told you it was a globe? Because it's not something you found out by yourself. It's not like fire burns, water is wet, you drop a pen on the floor, that's gravity. You know, apparently.
I can say honestly, I've never actually been up into space to be able to look at it.
There you go. Everything seems to funnel through one group. Because, okay, who told you? It's one of two answers. And I found, as I was asking more and more people this and talking to more and more people, it's always the same two answers. The first answer is always the same. And I should probably read the George Orwell quote real quick. Do you mind if I read this real quick?
Please.
Oh, okay. So I just found this couple, because the listeners that have been listening to my show and doing helping me out, they sent me a quote. It's from George Orwell, and he wrote this on December 27th, 1946, mind you, right? And it was at the end of this article about faith in science. And he was really using the round earth, flat earth as an example here. And he goes, most people, if asked to prove that the earth is round, would not even bother to produce the rather weak arguments I have outlined above. They would start off by saying that everyone knows the earth to be round, and if pressed further, would become angry. In a way, Shaw is right. This is a credulous age, and the burden of knowledge which we now have to carry is partly responsible. And I mentioned that quote because that's what I ran into all the time. When I say, how do you know the earth is a globe? And everyone comes back. The knee-jerk response is, well, duh, we know. You're an idiot. Of course we know. And I go, yeah, how do you know, though? Is it because you saw the globe in your classroom when you were 6 years old and it just stayed in the classroom until you made it through high school or college or whatever? Is that how you know? Or is it because you saw a single picture that was in a textbook and it's always the same picture? It was, in fact, it was literally the same picture from 1972 when Apollo 17 supposedly took it all the way up until June of last year, 2015. It was the same picture, and they milked it.
So that image that I'm picturing in my mind of the planet Earth that we've all seen 100,000 times in the Encyclopedia Britannica or whatever is the exact same image?
It's the only image. It was the literally only image, and I knew this.
That's interesting. I didn't know that.
I couldn't see the trees for the forest. This was right in front of my face in 2000, and I completely blew by it because nobody thinks of this. And that was when I was running a tech support team. I wanted to put an image of the Earth in all the monitors. And so I go and I look, and I'm doing a search for the Earth from space and space Earth, and I'm using all these different Boolean strings trying to find a picture of the Earth. And it's different than it was now back in 2000. It was just rows and rows and rows of the exact same image. You don't know which one I'm talking about. It's the one that shows the bottom part of Africa and of all of Antarctica. And that was literally it. And we know this. And we were challenging. We were saying, look, there's only one picture of the Earth from space for 43 years. And then all of a sudden, June of last year, no coincidence, the NASA releases the second blue marble shot. And we know this because they actually made it a press release. And the White House retweeted it. You can look it up and say, blue marble, 43 years. That's all you have to do is type in the search engine. And it'll pop this out. Heck, Obama mentioned it in a speech. And I actually clipped it out and put it at the front of one of my shows. And I'm going, okay, well, that's pretty interesting. Because where I'm going with this is, if you want to try to debunk the flat Earth, there should be mountains and mountains of evidence on the globe Earth side. There should be tens of thousands of pictures of the full Earth in sunlight from space. There should be thousands of hours of videos. Heck, there should be an HD channel right now running 24/7 that's showing the Earth rotating on its axis from some satellite somewhere. And what I found was there was only one picture, literally one picture for 43 years. And as far as videos goes, there's nothing. There's no videos. The only one they even remotely had, they disavowed later, was the 1990 Galileo footage, which showed the Earth rotating for 24 hours from a distance. But the problem was that a flat earther figured this out. The problem was the weather didn't morph. 24 hours, it turned around the same clouds as it came.
Oh, wow.
As it came back around. That was Matt Boylan that found that. And so one of our guys pretended to be a Hollywood producer and called up the NASA trademark office and put him on speakerphone and said, hey, yeah, I'm making a movie. You know, it sounded pretty credible. And I'm making a movie. And I need a shot of the Earth rotating from space. And the guy goes, yeah, we don't have that. What are you talking about? You're NASA. You've got all the footage. No, no. It's not. You know, he's trying to buy the rights to use the footage in a movie. And the guy goes, no.
What is stopping somebody from literally sending their own rocket up into the air? I mean, private space travel is a thing now. What's stopping Richard Branson or somebody like that from sending a satellite? Anybody sending a satellite up and filming this thing for real and seeing what's happening? Or is that something that
you
could
can't
be feasible within the next?
No, no. You can't. You can't do it. It's one is completely controlled from the ground up. I had a phone call with a group actually out in California. You can look these guys up. They're a competitor to SpaceX and Virgin Galactic, and they're called Interorbital. And they're right now, you can go on their website, they're selling moon rocks in advance, right, at like $5,000 a gram or something like that. It's ridiculous, right? And I talked to them, because I was kind of suspicious. I got lucky. There was a guy from Germany that knew the owners of this outfit and got me on a conference call. And I said, because my suspicion was, if you're going to fake everything, and by the way, for listeners out there that don't understand the gravity, again, no play on words there, of the situation that I'm throwing out.
I appreciate that.
No worries. Which is, I'm not just saying that the moon program was faked. I'm saying that the entire reason NASA was created in 1958 was to cover up where you live. They had to militarize space. They had to be the gatekeepers of the skies. So anyway, the point was, if that's true, then what would happen is anyone that was trying to launch a satellite up there, eventually NASA would take over the trajectory. And that was my theory. And so when I was talking to Interorbital, I go, so when you guys send a satellite up there, because you've done it in the past, you know, you have to let NASA know, right? And they go, no, we don't. I go, what happens? They go, oh, well, we have to contact this bureau out of Washington, D.C. It's the ATS, the Atmospheric and Transportation Safety Bureau.
The what?
Yeah, I know. I'm just going, who are these guys? And they go, oh, every country's got it, a branch of this. You have to file your flight plan in excruciating detail, months and months, like 6 to 9 months in advance, and let them know exactly what rocket's going up, exactly what the payload, exactly the frequency, what you're doing up there. So if your satellite is going to be resting at an altitude of, I don't know, 300 miles, and broadcasting at this sort of frequency, you're letting them know all this stuff in advance. I'm just going, well, that's awfully convenient, because if I was NASA, all I do is I take over the telemetry of this thing, use the old Loran system, which is really what all that's being used, and we can get into that later, and then you know, fake the transmission, you know, aka, you know, known as the Capricorn One scenario, and that's it. And then nobody on the ground knows the difference, because and forgive me if I'm rambling, but one of the big questions that comes up is like, no, this is too big to fake. You can't fake something this big. I'm just going, no, this isn't like the Manhattan Project, where everybody knew you were making atomic weapons. You know, there are hundreds of thousands of people, and it was a wartime effort, and everyone kept their mouth shut. This isn't like that. This is something so big that you really don't need to know. You know, you don't have a lot of people tell these things. My next door neighbor, when I was out in Boulder, Colorado, his name was Wayne Ottinger, Ottinger. He was like the grease monkey, the garage mechanic for NASA, for the Gemini and Mercury and the Apollo programs. He, you know, knew all the astronauts on a first name basis. So they're all on his Christmas card list. And he knew nothing. You know, his walls were covered in NASA plaques, you know, career JPL guy. And he knew nothing, because why would you tell him any of this stuff? You know, you let him build what he needs to build. So yeah, 99.99%. I'm saying this in advance in case somebody comes in and says, oh yeah, my grandfather worked for NASA. And it's like, yeah, that's great. He didn't know anything.
There's so many questions.
I know. I'm so sorry.
So many fucking questions.
One last question on that tip
sure.
Yeah, but what about, I'm sure
you I get a lot of them.
So many of those questions, yeah. But what about, not Earth, but all the other planets? We have a telescope, and we look through our telescope, and you can see a planet, and it's round.
Perfect. You go into a planetarium with a pair of binoculars. You look up at Jupiter. Does it look more real or less real? Doesn't matter, because it's fake, and you know that. The only difference is that you know going in that the illusion is broken, because you've gone in there. My argument is, if you have the technology, and by that I mean an advanced civilization, call it, you want to call it God, divine, whatever, intelligent design, if the civilization was powerful enough to build a planetarium thousands of miles wide and hundreds of miles high, could you fool an entire population inside it? How long could you keep it a secret? In our case, it looks like the better part of 5,000 years. Because we wouldn't have, you would have no way of figuring this thing out until the internal combustion engine was created, and then rocket technology. Until then, people were completely oblivious to it. They would have no idea. So,
who wouldn't want to experience? I mean, there's theories going back, and sorry to interrupt you, but there's theories going back as far back as I can remember reading that we are just one big petri dish for some sort of other species or interdimensional thing. You know, is it is. So why not take that the step further that this is all manufactured in one giant flat petri dish for real?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. And human beings have a really bad time with perception. We are, and I did this in Clue 12, which wasn't part of the original series, but I threw it in there for a nice little wrinkle, which is we have a hard time determining, which is why, for example, when you're at a parked, you're in stop and go traffic and you're zoning out and you all of a sudden can't figure out if the car next to you is moving or you're moving, one of those things, you don't know. Or for example, if you're one of those people that can watch a roller coaster movie on television, get ill. Because even though you know it's a television, we have a really, really bad time with perception. I use the you guys have probably been to Disneyland before, the Pirates of the Caribbean Pirates of the Caribbean ride, and that is when you go out, that final scene where you're in the boat and you go out into that harbor. It's a really nice looking harbor, and there's a horizon line way out in the distance, and you don't know how far away the boats are. The point is you don't know how far away those stars are. You know it's an illusion.
It's called forced perspective.
There you go.
That's the word.
Yeah.
Enforced detective.
So can...
Hey, we have to... Hold on. Sorry, I'm going to interrupt you. But we're going to take a quick break and it's network stuff. So if we don't do it, they yell at us.
Okay.
How it goes. But that gives us a chance to reset. When we get back, we have so many more questions for Mark Sargent that I'm going to start writing them down. So when we get back, I know all of them because there's a lot. If you have a question for Mark Sargent, we're talking Flat Earth. 888-919-2355 is the telephone number here at the Inception Radio Network. 888-919-2355.
Or you can go to irnchat.com, and if you are too nervous or scared to call us, as many of you are, but you like to talk online, you can go ahead and listen to us live and leave a question in the chat room, and we'll make sure that Mark gets it.
That's true, too. Okay, great. So you're listening to the Inception Radio Network. This is Truthfunders Radio. We're live with Mark Sargent, and we'll be this after you're back.
We are clear, guys.
How long were we down for?
Thank you.
We were down for about 2 minutes. I grabbed it right away and started the recording again. So I've probably lost about a minute and a half of content.
Cool. That's all right. Yeah, ask me about B.O.B. when you get back, because it's a really interesting story.
Is it your stuff that he's talking about?
Yeah.
Okay, so it is your stuff that he's talking about.
Yeah.
I was hoping that was the case.
Yeah, he's used a couple of my catchphrases. Now, the video he points to is going to be Eric Dubay, because Eric Dubay is, he's got a lot of detailed stuff out there. But B.O.B. is a flat earther, and the fact that he went after Neil deGrasse Tyson was brilliant. It did nothing but help us, even though Neil, did that overreaction.
It is such a crazy concept, but like you say, man, there's literally no fucking proof.
What, of flat Earth?
Yeah, well, no, of Glober.
Oh, for Glober, no, and I get in heated arguments with Glober's people because they say, you got to prove the Earth is flat. I'm just going, no, dude, prove it's a globe, because that should be easy. You got 500 years worth of proof on your side. Go ahead, try, find it. And then they start getting angry, and I feel bad because when people flip. And they do. There's no apologies. It's like, it's so weird watching them. It's like watching a zombie thing where it's like, I hate flat Earth, and all of a sudden, hey, flat Earth's not bad. What? It's like they join in the pride parade. It's just bizarre. And you'll see. I mean, there's a lot of comparisons there. There's flat earthers in the closet. That's what we're waiting for in the next one. We thought Tila Tequila was kind of a fluke, but then B.O.B. came out. I was like, wow. No idea what's going on there.
Yeah, well, we're definitely going to be talking about all that. A lot of our show deals with the effects of, social media in the paranormal landscape. And that this would be paranormal, but I guess paranormal people would be more open to this idea at first.
Well, you'd think
this is paranormal. Are you kidding me? This is the definition of paranormal.
Yeah, absolutely. I wasn't kidding when I said in my clues, I said I have run into people that are absolutely convinced that all the royals are lizards, and And they're look at me with a straight face. And if I say, oh, yeah, I got one for you, flat earth. And they just laugh and cackle and wave me off. And I can't get mad at them because, like, look, if you would have told me that, you know, at the beginning of 2014, I would have laughed you out of the room, too. Would have totally done it. And my phone doesn't stop ringing. So
that's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll bring that up.
Thank you, by the way, that you listened to the Jimmy Church show. I haven't even put that one up because he hasn't released that one.
Oh, he hasn't?
Well, no.
Yeah, I actually. So Jimmy and I kind of go back to the beginning of the show. I was the one who put him in touch with Lee Spiegel from Huffington Post and David Schwartz, the geologist at the USGS, who both Lee talked to him, the geologist, about, you know, what's going on underwater, and interviewed Jimmy about that. That article actually helped to get Jimmy sort of on the map. He got noticed. ABC7 came and did a news story on him.
Nice.
And then, so I was talking with him about, you know, when George Norrie first approached him to be on Coast to Coast and what he should do. Like we talked about all that stuff. And Truthfunders we used to be a website up until a month ago. We closed the website down, but we were doing it was like crowdfunding for paranormal projects.
Oh, cool.
We were one of the main sponsors on Jimmy's show for about 3 months early last year.
Oh, neat.
Yeah, so he's a cool guy. Yeah, he really loves
it. Are we back?
Yep, I'm going to crank it here.
MJ's healthy way. Yeah, we're back here live on the Inception Radio Network. My name is Art Webb, up here with Mark Schwartz and Mark Sargent, and we're talking Flat Earth Theory on this particular episode of the program. 888-919-2355 is the telephone number here at Truthfunders Radio. I have two questions for you, Mark, that I wrote down. My first one, and I want to get to the B.O.B. stuff soon because sure. That is totally worth talking about.
Yeah.
And for those of you that are playing along at home, if you don't know what the B.O.B. story is, go ahead while you're listening here, open up a browser and just search B.O.B. and Flat Earth and the whole thing will come up on Twitter. But my question preceding that is this. Looking at the Flat Earth theory, now we all know that the Earth is not in actuality flat like a pancake because it does go like very deep down in the ocean. There's that Mariana Trench or whatever, that thing that James Cameron did all the way down at the bottom of the ocean.
Yeah.
How far do we have to drill based on what you've found so far to get to China, to get to the other side? If it's not in actuality a globe with a magma mantle or whatever it is, how thick is this thing? Or do we even know? Can we even begin to speculate?
Well, you can't because you can't even find out how thick the globe is. And people say, no, we know exactly how thick the globe is. We've all seen the cross section, which looks like a gobstopper, which goes from red to orange.
Yeah, that cutout one that was also in our history books that we've all seen.
We've all seen that. And so I was going, oh, that's great. So you guys have drilled that far, right? Because it's 4,000 miles to the center of the Earth if it's a globe. And it's like,
I saw that movie.
There you go. Oh, the core? Yeah, nice.
Yeah, I saw that movie.
Yeah, and it's like, well, so you're going to what? You're going 1,000 miles? No. 100? 10? No. The deepest hole ever drilled is 8 miles, and that's a fraction of 1%. But yet, they're going to show us
a fraction of 1% of what they claim.
Exactly. A fraction of 1% of what they say the globe is. So it's like, how deep is the flat Earth? We don't even know how deep the globe Earth is because we can't dig down that far. No drilling company has ever drilled below 8 miles and that's 12 kilometers Canadian. Because once you get down that far, the heat turns the bits to mush and you can't go any further, supposedly. And the Russians, they were the big ones on it. They tried doing it for years and years and years. And now they're thinking of rebooting the whole thing and starting in the water, where the Myres Trench, which you were talking about. So no, we don't know how thick it is. I could take a stab. I mean, but it could be 50, 200 miles thick. I kind of guessed in the clues I was doing because I think that there are caverns down there because I think this thing is a giant machine, and I think the heating system and there's
well, hold on,
yeah,
a giant machine. So wait a minute. So it is thick enough though that we could be traversing the globe via a boat, and we wouldn't necessarily notice when we're flipping around to the other side. I mean, it is at least that thick, right?
Well, yeah. No, you can't. And a lot of people, the first thing they say is, well, if it's flat, aren't you gonna? If you're getting on a boat, aren't you gonna fall off the edge? you know, Pirates of the Caribbean style. It's like, no.
Not necessarily.
Well, but some people will say that. We all know, we've heard the stories. And it's like, no, because the one difference on the flat Earth map, which is very, very different from the globe map, is that Antarctica isn't this continent that's sort of a frozen continent that sort of looks like Australia. It's like 13 million square miles. It's actually much, much bigger, and it spreads around the entire outer edge, and it's really just a giant Antarctic coastline that starts at 200 feet of ice straight up off the water. We know this because we've seen pictures. And right. then it goes, and then it starts sloping up very, very fast to where it's a giant plateau at about 2 miles, pushing 14,000 feet in some places and sometimes higher. And that's where it continues on. And no indigenous plant life, no animal life, no ruins or anything like that. But yeah, it continues around the entire outside edge. So the oceans are held in just fine by a giant continent, which we call Antarctica.
So I have a question for you from our chat room.
Oh, I bet.
yeah, so Sky33 asks, do you believe that we went to the moon? And I guess that's a pretty relative question.
It is a pretty relative question.
If you were on the moon, you know, if you believe we went to the moon, then we would be able to take pictures of Earth. Or
there you go.
Not only that, but, you know, it kind of plays into the NASA conspiracy, I suppose.
The first thing you're going to have to give up, unfortunately, because the Fall Guy, really the gatekeepers for this whole thing, and I know I've gotten some flack because people say I'm picking on them, but the gatekeepers for this whole thing is NASA. NASA was created in 1958. The entire reason they were created was to control the sky, was to gatekeep the sky, because they could not let private corporations eventually, you know, like what Orwell was saying back in 1946, sooner or later, and I got to give credit to Matt Boylan here, because he was the one that kind of proposed the idea, he goes, sooner or later, you've got to release a picture of the Earth. But you can't just hand people a picture of the Earth, even though it's, you know, an artist's rendering, you know, nice doctored something. You can't hand it to them because people say, oh, how'd you take it? You've got to create a fake space program to at least create the illusion that you got high enough to take the shot. And I know if you're in America, and look, I'm American, I love the whole idea of NASA as a space organization. But remember, they are a military organization. They are part of the DOD. They were founded on the still burning embers of the Nazi war machine. If you have any doubt of that, look up Wernher von Braun and all his cronies. You know, it's a very, yeah, I know they wear white outfits and they don't carry guns and they smile for the camera a lot. I get that. But they are strictly part of the, you know, part of the military force. And you got to give up NASA. The moon mission, the moon mission's been torn apart for years. We all know that. There's been so many documentaries. I don't even know which one to pick.
Yeah. I would say. And it would make a whole lot of sense as to why we had to fake the entire thing.
That's my point. Absolutely. You know? That bugged me for at least 10 years, which was why would we fake the moon missions? It doesn't make any sense. Plant a flag, rah-rah, go USA. Doesn't make any sense. But then I got into this, and all of a sudden it just dawned on me. I said, oh, okay, it's not.
So,
hold on. You mentioned a couple moments ago that you think that the entire planet is in fact one big machine.
Yeah, it's a big planetarium / terrarium / mechanical device.
So it's a functional thing,
a real functional moving parts.
I mean, what's powering it? Why is it being powered? Are we spinning? Are we even spinning?
No.
How is gravity? No. Okay, so
no.
Spinning?
We're not spinning. There is no really, when they made that big leap of faith 500 years ago and say, okay, it's not flat anymore. Because remember, before 500 years ago, that's exactly what everybody thought. It's like, okay, we're in a flat disk and there's a canopy, the Old Testament, firmament type stuff from Genesis 1:6. And then they said, okay, if the Earth is spinning, it works. If the Earth is spinning at 1,000 miles an hour at the equator, and it's going around the sun at 60,000 miles an hour, and the solar system is moving through the galaxy at 500,000 miles an hour. But no, this is a flat, stationary, motionless Earth. Nothing is moving except for whatever's running the systems in here. And by that, I mean the stars are moving around the sky like a planetarium. The oceans are moving because of the underwater conveyor system. The air is moving because of the jet stream. The magma system, whatever the heck is powering the magma system down below.
So, Mark,
what?
Someone else asked in our chat room, then who do you think made it? Who do you think made Earth?
Really? You're gonna jump to the last page of the book? Really? That quickly?
I got to.
No, that's fine. All right. I don't know, and I had to deal with this when I was making the clues, because people are saying, well, you're dodging the God issue. It's like, look, whoever made this, at the very least, are extremely powerful. Are they an advanced civilization? Yes, at the very least, they're an advanced civilization. Are they God? Well, you know, whoever shows up to take claim for this thing, a lot of religious people, and you know, that's 80% of the population of the world, they're going to look at it and say, yeah, intelligent design, there's a handprint of God, therefore it's probably created by God.
By the way, this also leads the question to the sun and the moon. Are they created by the things?
The whoever created this place?
Whoever created this as well, or the sun and the moon all part of the illusion that we perceive?
The sun and the moon appear to be, and I know there's some division in the flat earth movement. I mean, there's a lot of people in this thing. But the sun and the moon to be different than they would be in a planetarium. In a planetarium, you know, you can get the sun to rise and set like the Truman Show, and the moon to rise and the set, and you can. It's all part of the same system. It's just a projection on the ceiling. But in this system that we're living in, the sun and the moon.
There's no ceiling. That's what I'm saying. Is there a ceiling in is there a ceiling?
In this, I believe so. Yes. No, I do believe in the firmament. And by the way, so did Wernher von Braun. Everyone, look. Somebody punch up that on a screen. Look up Wernher von Braun's headstone. You'd think it'd be this big guy pointing at the sky, looking up, you know, in grand splendor with a big rocket behind him. No, it's just a little headstone that says Wernher von Braun, year he was born, year he died, and then Psalms 19:1. It's like, what's Psalms 19? You know what Psalms 19:1 is? And the firmament shows his handiwork. Why in the world is the father of rocket science putting that on his headstone? It makes no sense. I think he's throwing a breadcrumb from the grave.
1912 to 1977, Psalms 19:1.
Yeah, couldn't make that up if I tried. But yeah, I do believe there's a ceiling, and I do believe the stars and the planets are projected on it, but the moon and the sun are physical objects. And they're...
That exists inside of the ceiling.
Yeah, like objects that are like a mobile floating above a child's crib. So the sun is really just a big incandescent light bulb.
So the ceiling is huge. We're in if we were in a warehouse, this is a massive fucking warehouse.
Yeah.
I mean, it's got to be able to encapsulate the sun and the moon, and I guess even the other planets if we're going mobile.
Well, yeah, but the planets don't have to be real because they're not, you don't have the ability to...
Well, they're all gassy. Half of them are, three quarters of them are gassies to begin with.
Well, exactly. Yeah, you're not... Well, not matters because you're not going there anyway. But the sun is an incandescent light bulb. The moon is apparently its own nightlight and self-illuminated because there's no... You know, everything... There's so many things you could go down. Two things people should look up on the moon.
Because this is interesting about the moon being self-illuminated.
Yeah, two things about the moon people should look up. One is lunar waves. If you get a chance, look up why there is a refresh issue with the moon that we've only been able to detect with HD cameras recently, zooming in, meaning that there seems to be a vertical hold issue, like the refresh rate is slightly out of sync with the cameras that we're using now, and we'll be able to detect that. But the second thing is the moonlight is actually generating some sort of refrigerant radiation. And by that I mean, I'll do it real quick, and that is, we all know in a hot place it's 100 degrees in the sun and it's 90 degrees in the shade. Everyone gets that. But if you're in the moonlight, it's, let's take a stab here, it's 50 degrees in the moonlight, but it's 60 degrees in the shade. That doesn't make any sense. It's reversed, meaning the moonlight is actually chilling things. And we know this because the new digital thermometers, especially the infrared point and click thermometers, you can go out there and test this any time you want. There's people saying, no, it's just...
So you're saying that it's like when the moon comes out, it gives off sort of like a refrigerator type temperature?
Yeah,
And chills things, and then the sun heats it up during the day?
Something to that effect. I mean, we've seen
such a cool thought.
Who doesn't want to be thrown in the oven and back in the refrigerator for 12 hours? I sure, you know,
there's a difference sometimes in a full moon of 12 degrees between the moonlight and the moonshade, meaning the moonlight is 12 degrees colder than the moonshade.
Now, why does the moon? Now, why do you have any theories as to why the moon goes through the lunar cycle? And further to that point, I mean, I think that everybody is pretty much in agreement here that when we have a full moon, energetically speaking, on the planet, things are different than when we do not have a full moon. There's a buzz in the air.
Yeah,
is that all interconnected?
It's got to be interconnected because the moon. Well, let's face it. I mean, if the flat Earth model is right, there is no Earth between the sun and the moon, which means everything you see on the moon. It's just a display. So if it's a half moon, three quarter, it's a blood red moon. I mean, that's easy from a programming standpoint. It's like, okay,
yeah,
call,
no, it's true.
Color of the
Moon.
Supermoon. Yep, supermoon. And remember, these things aren't, when they're rotating above us, they're not rotating in the exact same orbit every time, because you have to account for seasons and all this other fun stuff, even though the seasons are only partially caused by these objects. So it's like a needle on a record player, how the song goes, you know, as the song plays on, the needle gets closer and closer to the center. Right. And if you reverse it, it go further and further out. And yeah, that's where we are. Sorry, I'm sure you got more questions.
So there's two questions that I want to bring up here, Mark. One, I want to know more about who you think, you know, these beings are that created it.
Yeah.
But I also want to get into sort of to bring it back to relevance in today's culture. Mm-hmm. What's going on and how this thing is starting to snowball.
Yeah.
And how more and more people are picking up this theory. And you know, B.O.B. tweeting about it.
Yeah.
So B.O.B. is a rapper to our audience, who I'm sure all of you guys know that anyways. But he seems to be a flat earth theorist as well, and
yeah,
was tweeting a lot of what was it, the content that you created?
Some of it, yes. He, you know, I drilled into at the end of every clue. He used two lines that I used, which was do your own research and ask questions. And I smile whenever I hear that, because I burned that in. I said that enough times throughout the clues that I keep, every time somebody says it, it's like, oh, right on, it's cool. You know, I'm glad I'm hypnotizing people.
So, you know where it came from.
Yeah, I know where it came from. So how that whole thing started, and this kind of relates to more like who created this, because I do think it's part of the natural process. I do think that this place was initially set up as a sim, you know, at least the globe part was set up as a simulation to buy some time for the creators, but that we were supposed to find it naturally. But it started out, I think, at the end of last year, when Tila Tequila, you probably heard of her, MTV ex-reality star, she actually mentioned it. She did a big tweet rant and went on and said the Earth was flat. And she caught a lot of flack for it. But she knew, I'm pretty sure she was, you know, rubbed elbows with B.O.B., who was Grammy nominated in, I think, 2010. And so B.O.B. came out at the end of January, you know, not just a couple weeks ago. And he goes on a Twitter rant, and he goes into it basically all night and just saying, oh, yeah, you know, the Earth is flat, and you know, here's all these references, and he's pointing to stuff, and he's making his case. And then he releases a song. He actually, you know, quick, down and dirty song called Flatline, which is not the hospital reference Flatline. It's the Flatline of the Horizon. And the lyrics then were pretty good. But at the end of it, he actually used a full 60-second soundbite of Neil deGrasse Tyson. And he accused Tyson in the song.
Tyson's getting paid for that.
Exactly. He goes, hope he's getting one hell of a check, right, for what he's – no. That's what he said in the song, which is ironic, because he was – anyway, Tyson didn't get paid for doesn't really matter. The point was, less than 12 hours later, Tyson, you'd think there'd be phone calls made and something in private. No, Tyson gets on the Twitter, and he's going back, and he's throwing some stuff out on him. And then Tyson's nephew, Stephen Tyson, he gets involved and makes a rap song. It was a ripoff of one of Drake's tunes. I don't know Drake very well. But Drake, you know, he did and it was called Flat or Fact. And where Neil deGrasse Tyson, he wasn't rapping, but he actually used, you know, made his own sound bites for that particular song. So there's a rap battle going on between the world's most popular physicist and a Grammy-nominated rapper. That's happening. And then to top it off, the very next morning after he, then what happened? So then that night... He goes on, he's already booked shows. He goes on Comedy Central and another show, and goes on and you know, with a black t-shirt, and, you know, Neil deGrasse Tyson does, and saying how the Earth isn't flat, blah, 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 and then drops the mic, you know, the same rehearsed thing on both things, drops the mic and walks off stage. But his arguments really weren't that good. And then the weirdest thing, so I thought that was over, right? Okay, it's over, you know, that the rap battle's over, we don't have to deal with it anymore. And then the next morning, I watched this thing where somebody had sent it to me, a listener, because nothing is missed, where, again, you can look this up, Leonardo DiCaprio is in the Vatican. talking to the Pope, you know, because Pope's time.
The Catholics know this to be true too, right?
All religions have, you know, religions have not forgotten about this. But yeah, the Catholics know it. So Leonardo DiCaprio is sitting there, you know, because he only got 15 minutes to talk with him about climate change, because, you know, the Pope is a very busy guy. And he's giving him this book, and he's showing him this picture, and he stops in the middle of this thing and goes, oh, by the way, this is a picture of Hieronymus Bosch. This picture was above my crib as a child. It depicts the earth when people thought it was flat. And he says, to me, it represents the promise of future and enlightenment. And it's like, what are you doing? Why are you talking about this? And so anyway, that was a...
So do you believe Leo to be a closeted flat earth theorist, allegedly?
I don't know. And then I watched, I should send you the thing. There was a neat little thing where most people don't know that Taylor Swift is a huge nerd, right? And she does some of her own IT work. And one of her things is called Securite. It's from Secure, you know, but she's got like 112,000 followers, you know, for this little IT login that she has on Twitter. And she actually retweeted, it was a Flat Earth bingo card, which was really weird. I was going, why are these people? So now we're waiting. Now, do I think she's a closet flat earther? Not really. But I do think that there are closet flat earthers out there that are just waiting for their time, because, you know, who do you come out to? Who do you talk about this with?
So then let me ask you, you know, it's sort of who are the top people in the society of flat earth as far as the flat earth experts? I mean, I'd consider you one of the most, the biggest,
okay, I'll give you a brief history of how this thing really, really came about, because people, I'm not, you know, and people will be listening, I'm going to post this on my site, and people will, you know, I'm not going to embellish here, and that was... Matt Boylan was probably the first guy to talk about it, because he was the guy that was supposedly, that NASA supposedly dropped it to, and said, oh yeah, by the way, the Earth is flat. But he was 24, and that was back, that was a long time ago. He's 38 now. And so that was rattling around in his head for a while. So he was trying to tell people. He was an artist. He's got a super creative mind, but he doesn't know how to dumb it down for people. You know, the average guy on the street, he kept going, photo or painting, man. It's all about the system and overturning it. And, you know, he's going in all sorts of different directions. And there were some people that were listening and some people that weren't. And then another guy named Eric Dubay came out. And he kind of, you know, put together a little book thing, and it was going okay. And then I came out, and again, there was a couple other people, a couple from Germany, a couple from Europe that were doing it. And then I came out and did my Flat Earth Clues series. And that's when people got it. It was like, I really just sat down and I go, you know, because there was no more static to it anymore. I go, look, this is how Flat Earth is possible. Somebody shoot it down. And they didn't. And here we, and you know, the 1 year anniversary of my Flat Earth Clues was a week ago today, and no one has. In fact, it's gotten worse and weirder and weirder. Do you really think? I honestly thought that a scientist was going to call me up or email me and blow me out of the water within the first month. I honestly thought that. I thought there's something I missed. There's a little detail I missed.
So if there's this big conspiracy by NASA,
yeah.
And so this is two questions. Yeah. What about all the other superpowers of the world that, you know, are they all in it together? And why and how would they all be in it together?
No,
you don't get people out in the sky.
Go ahead.
And my other question is, when did this become, you know, like, when did you start appearing on all the shows and this start kind of snowballing and getting bigger?
Okay, the first part is that the United States, the people who were mostly responsible for covering this thing up in 1956, after Operation Deep Freeze by Admiral Byrd, were the United States and the Soviet Union at the time, who's now disbanded.
What was Operation Deep Freeze?
Operation Deep Freeze was the last mission that Admiral Byrd, Richard E. Byrd, ever took down to Antarctica. And he was down there.
I know. I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, he was most known for Hollow Earth theory, but he spent the rest of his life, almost 30 years, looking for what I thought that was the edge down in Antarctica. And when they found it, you know, even though they didn't say they found it, everything that they did, it was really the Russians and the Americans for the longest time. You know, they were the ones that headed up the whole Antarctic Treaty, which was signed in 1959. It is ironclad. No corporation can ever go down there. for anything ever, no matter how much money you have, which goes against every principle of capitalism we've ever heard.
Wait a minute, that's real. No corporation.
That's a real thing.
They're not allowed to go down there. Wow, yeah, I had no idea.
Yeah, 1959. In fact, isn't even up for review until 2041. I've never seen a treaty like this. Let's say you're the president of Exxon, right? You can get in anywhere, right? President of Exxon, you could start fracking in my backyard, and there's nothing I can do to stop you. I mean, I can slow you down maybe, but there's nothing I can do to stop you. And not only is Exxon, for example, not allowed to go down there, they're not even allowed to talk about it. They can't lobby anybody. You can't lobby anybody in Congress. You can't grease palms. You can't even call up your friends of the New York Times.
Yeah, but I would think, why would they want to? Because there's a lot going on down in Antarctica.
Okay, here's why, and you guys can look this up whenever you get it. It's in my clues, but it's pretty cool. And that is in 1954. Look this up. Admiral Richard E. Byrd. You can look it up on YouTube. Somebody from a CBS affiliate put up a 1954, kind of like a 60 Minutes thing. It was called the Long Jeans Chronoscope. And he goes on there, and it's not like a rough cut or anything. It's a full-blown show. And he's going on there, and he says, because I think that he had given up. I think he figured out, well, whatever I'm looking for, I'm not going to find it. And he goes, look, this whole place is made out of money. He goes, there's an entire mountain range made out of coal. There's oil, there's minerals, uranium. In fact, he was worried that all the countries that were down there, Great Britain, Russia, Chile, Argentina, New Zealand, Australia, he thought there was going to be conflicts of people fighting over resources. And then Operation Deep Freeze changed all that. Once Operation Deep Freeze happened, everybody got off the ice almost immediately, and they unilaterally, I use that word, I can't put enough emphasis on it, unilaterally, all nations agreed on it right away and says, yeah, nobody can ever go down there again.
let's leave it at that, and we'll pick back up on that note as soon as we get back from this break. We're talking with Mark Sargent. We're talking with Mark Schwartz. You're listening to Truthfunders Radio on the Inception Radio Network. Flat Earth, Antarctica. Antarctica is one of my favorite topics because it is the biggest mystery left on this planet, and there's so much going on down there. We can't even begin to scratch the surface, but I hope to when we get back, because I would love to talk more about Antarctica and whatever it is you want to talk about here on the Truthfunders live radio show on the Inception Radio Network, and we will be right back.
On the Inception Radio,
it's a really fun show. Thank you, Mark.
Oh, no, thank you. So
yeah,
so
it's great. And you're so articulate and definitely passionate about it that it comes across.
Yeah, you might be like one of like the top five guests we've ever had. Really? In terms of being able to properly
hold your ground,
spell out what you're saying and keep a point, you know.
Well, thanks.
Arrive at a point that you're trying to make instead of meandering constantly. You know, you're very, 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 very good guest.
Well, thank you, very, very, very much. By the way, will I have access to this audio later?
Yes, absolutely. We will. We'll send you a copy, but you can also download it from iTunes. And if you signed in or if you have the Inception Radio Network app, you can access it there too.
Okay. Are we actually live right now?
Yeah, we're live. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Cool.
Yeah, MJ, can you send him a copy of the show when it's done, especially
for
Mark, because he's requesting it?
I'll send him a file. Yes, I'll send the link to it. I'll write it in my notes right here.
Perfect.
Great. Yeah, it's someone just wrote that it's interesting. Like, we have a couple of mega fans that are always here, and then we have randoms that always appear. Mm-hmm. But in the chat room, people are saying that it's like very interesting and they're enjoying it. So,
oh, good.
You know, we appreciate that.
At least they're not grabbing pitchforks and torches.
How was it on Darkness Radio? You came back for that second night and were asked a bunch of questions. Did you have a good time?
Oh yeah, yeah. I don't mind questions. I got hit with questions really on with like Ground Zero and Coast to Coast.
Oh, you were on with Clyde?
Yeah,
I was. I produced Clyde's show for. Oh shit, man! It was a few years. I worked with Clyde. I love Clyde. He's a good dude.
Yeah,
hey,
yeah.
MJ, I gotta run to the bathroom. I'll be right back.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead.
Yeah, Clyde Lewis was he was, because this was early on. That was one of my earlier interviews, and this is before the Flat Earth really started to take off. And so the people that were calling in, it was like, you know, they couldn't even believe that they were talking. That's the biggest response you will hear, and that is, I can't believe you're actually talking about this, because people say, well, this is a given. This thing was solved 500 years ago, and then I come back and it's like, really? Was it? How do you know? Are you sure you knew? And that was the intro to my clues, which was, yeah, we all know that it's round, of course, but the problem was, When they said it was round, it was 500 years ago, and they had absolutely no way of proving it. Yeah, fine, you could do your math, but until you could get a rocket up high enough to take a picture, what do you really know? And by that time, you had, what, 25 generations of people go through the system, and you know, it's amazing.
Well, it's captivating, and I tell you that we need, or whether it's true or whether it's not true, we need more good riveting conspiracy theories out there to kind of get people's brains thinking. And and what's really intriguing about this theory is that it fits in so well with all of the other ones. Like, I really feel like it it's like you know, if people think we didn't go to the moon, and some people think, you know, that we're being visited by aliens.
Mark, yeah. Want to bring us back?
Oh, sure, I'll bring us back. I'll pick that up on the air.
Sure.
It'll be starting in a second. You'll hear it.
Truthfunders Radio on the Inception Radio Network.
Ha! We're back here live on the Inception Radio Network. My name is Art Webb. I'm here with Mark Schwartz and Mark Sargent. And we're talking Flat Earth and Antarctica. And I literally sat down as the show was coming back, so I'm sure Mark thought he was going to pick up the comeback, but I tried to jump in.
You snagged it away from me.
That's why I was so, you know, that's why I came and shot out of a cannon. Hey, Mark, Sargent, so more on Antarctica, because Antarctica is probably one of my favorite topics, if not my favorite topic. There's so much weird shit going on in Antarctica. And just as you were mentioning before we went into the break, you know, by the way, your whole theory gives new credence to the term spaceship Earth, for sure.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I was just telling Mark during the break that, you know, we need more conspiracy theories out there. I mean, it's been a while since there's one that's like really good that sweeps you off of your feet. And the way Mark delivers it, it's very passionate. So
we need
really,
more people
really
like Mark. I think, Mr. Schwartz, what you're trying to say, it's not that we need more conspiracy theories, because there are many a conspiracy theory out there. We need more people like Mark Sargent, being cheerleaders for theories that are maybe outside of the regularly accepted, you know, way of things. People, I forgot what I'm trying to say. What I'm saying is that he knows what he's talking about, and he's articulate, and he's a good spokesman for his cause. And I think that we need more people like that.
But one thing about
certainly
this
not me.
In particular, one theory about this theory in particular, Art and Mark, is that it really it enhances a lot of other theories that are already out.
It fits
in like the missing puzzle piece in so many ways.
It doesn't demolish any of them. As a matter of fact, I was just thinking that today, and I was going, you know, if all the conspiracies that are out there are like chess pieces on the board, this one is really different because it is the board that everything else sits on. Meaning, you know, who's gonna know about JFK in 1,000 years? Probably nobody. But this board will still be there. Pieces move; they come and go. But the world in which we live on, that's forever. Well,
now let me ask you this: do you believe that the ancients were more aware of this, like the ancient Egyptians, for example, and their building of the Great Pyramids, excuse me.
Yeah,
to, you know, match Orion's belt or whatever. I mean, do you think that these are things that were known in the past, or do you think that this is all, you know?
Yeah, I think it's all part of the natural process. I think eventually every civilization, because it's obvious we're not the first people to rent this apartment by any stretch. You know, how many a sunken city off of Japan or off of India, or you know, buried cities here and there, or the pyramids. Don't tell me they're just 5,000 years old. I've been there. Those things are really, really old. But the point is that I think every civilization reaches a stage where they realize where they are, and then once that happens, then the system either has to adjust, or the creators show up, or whatever happens. I think that we were supposed to figure it out.
That's an interesting concept. Maybe once you figure out what it is behind the door, then it's almost like, you know, hey, you won. Now we'll come out and show ourselves.
There was a flat earther that said, and I can't remember his name to save my life, but he said that it's like, once the students sit down and they finally figure out that they're in the classroom, that's when the teacher comes in. And I was going, wow.
That's a great way to put it. That just gave me chills.
Yeah, I know. It's like, okay. Is that, because that's what it kind of feels like. I mean, let's not kid ourselves. The fact that this thing hit mainstream media a few weeks ago in a big, big way. I mean, everybody from Time Magazine to MTV to, I mean, I had a friend call me up. She was in a wine bar, and she goes, you know, I'm looking on my phone at NPR. You never guess what I'm looking at. Do you have anything to what's going on here? And I go, yeah, I do, actually. But if mainstream is covering it, it feels like it's a lead in for something else. You know, like it's like there's some, like it's a combination of things. So I do think.
But the religious organizations, you do believe to have a knowing hand in what's going on, especially the oldest ones.
They know, but because science really has a stranglehold on.
Who do you think figured it out in 1956? What percentage of today's population do you believe to be in the know as to the reality of the situation?
Oh, tiny.
Like, actually in the know.
A tiny fraction of 1%. It's so far. I mean, think of the people, but it didn't matter for the longest time. So let's say you were the king of France in, I don't know, 1600, and you had a map that showed you exactly what the earth looked like. Who cares? What are you going to do with it? Until the internal combustion engine is created 300 years later, you don't have the ability to look for it. So that's why, as soon as the planes were invented, that's when Admiral Byrd was sent. You know, don't think he did it on his own. He was ordered to do this. I mean, he spent literally from 1928 all the way until 1957 down in Antarctica looking for something. And when he found it, you know, that's when it changed. I think they were looking for some sort of edge, because you can't define.
And you do believe that he found it?
Oh yeah, yeah, no question in my mind. He found
that's
some.
That's why you think, and that was the moment that they kicked everybody out of Antarctica.
Yep, kicked everybody out of Antarctica, and then everything gets really nutty after that. The rocket program ramps up between the Soviet Union and the United States, and then a year after the rocket program starts, they put atomic weapons on the top of their rockets, and they just fire up.
Because they found the edge, and they felt like, well, we got to get out and see what's going on.
Well, it's a typical guy response. It's like, oh, hey, look, we're inside something. Well, maybe we can punch a hole through it. So they yeah. literally fired atomic weapons from 1958 until 1962, both the Russians and the Americans, four straight years. That's all they did, was fire up. They gave up. Finally.
Well, there's also some speculation that the atomic testing that they were doing in the atmosphere is playing a pretty big role in what we're now experiencing with climate change, too.
Could be. Could have been a side effect. I mean, what? We didn't know dick about radiation back then. So
we still don't. We're still paying the consequences. Yeah. I mean, if Fukushima doesn't kill us all, it's going to be certainly something along those lines of us 50 years ago, or however long it was, sending that much radiation up into our atmosphere and ultimately, being our own.
Yeah.
So Mark, where does it go from here? Like, what are your plans? Do you are you creating new content for people to look at? Are there maps out there? What do you hope to do with this? I mean, do you truly deep down believe that this is the way it is? And what are you trying to do?
Still waiting to be proven wrong, because
until somebody shoots this whole thing down, I'm going to keep doing what I'm doing. I have my own little Strange World show on Truth Frequency Radio. I do another show.
Where can people listen to that?
TruthFrequencyRadio.com, or just go to my YouTube channel, Mark K. Sargent. But really, just type in Flat Earth Clues into any search engine. You'll find it. You know, there's lots of mirrors out there for this stuff. But to answer your question bluntly, I absolutely believe in this thing, because if it hasn't been shot down in a year, and just about every university professor, I think, has been contacted at some point, you know, by either one of our people or somebody out, you know, in the general public just asking questions, if they haven't shot it down by now, I don't think they're going to. Neil deGrasse Tyson's people, they shut me down before the Art Bell closed. One of the last shows he was going to do before Art Bell closed down was me. I was supposed to be on there against Stanton Friedman. And we got Stanton because Neil deGrasse Tyson refused to do it. Although now he's going on air and saying, no, I don't do debates. And it's like, all right, that's fine.
But I do remember Neil being on our show maybe like 2 weeks before.
He was. Yeah. He was on the show, and it was real innocent email. I watched the chain where a producer said, "Hey, how would you like to come on the show and talk about the shape of the earth, Mark Sargent?" It's like, that is never going to happen. I mean, it was like really deadpan. Yeah, don't ask. It wasn't a scheduling conflict or anything. It's like, that's never, ever going to happen. And, you know, Flat Earth was never mentioned in those emails. I was like, all right, that's fine.
You must feel great, though, that one of the top scientists in our country is bringing up your stuff and even trying to slam it. I mean, that's got to feel – You gotta feel good about it.
I do. Look, I'm trying to be as humble as I can, because I've never seen a conspiracy where there are moves made on the other side that seem to be reactionary to what we're doing. And I'm not going to take credit. There's so many people in the Flat Earth movement now, and they're doing so much good work. I mean, yeah, I made the clues, and I'm doing my own shows, and I'm interviewing the subject matter people, that experts that have come out from the military and the professional sector to verify what I'm saying. No, I haven't gotten a NASA guy yet, but I'm working on it. Those are all great.
How do they respond? So you bring them onto your show and you talk to them about it, and they're like, do they say you're ridiculous? No. Or do they, like, what is the overall general conversation like?
That's just it. They come on, and it's all pro. And I haven't had to solicit a single one. They've all contacted me. Of course, it helps that I put my phone number out there. Boy, if I had to do something over again, I don't know if I'd put my phone number out there on the end of my videos. But but I mean, I've got.
By the way, I have Mark's phone number here. I didn't know.
You can throw it out there. I mean, I have to screen all the calls now anyway. But before I didn't, I just pick up the phone. It's like, hey, what's going on? You want to talk about Flat Earth? But I've had, like, for example, I've had Navy missile instructor, Air Force navigator, Marine Corps sniper instructor, Navy submarine chief, artillery radar operator, Australian intelligence, flight instructor, industrial engineer, career surveyor, international shipping expert, a corporate travel agent, and I just did an air traffic controller last night. And all of them say the same thing. It's like, yeah. There's no curve. The Earth isn't spinning, and the maps are wrong, and they just keep confirming. Everybody's building.
Why are they all saying this to you? I mean, are they all coming to you because they feel like there's nowhere else they can go to talk about these things?
Because I'm the easiest guy to get a hold of.
Right, and they can't talk to anyone else about this. But if this is what they're seeing on an everyday basis, they're going to want to talk to somebody about it.
Yeah, absolutely. And they all say the same thing. It's like, yeah, we've all heard of the curve. We've all heard of the Earth spinning, but we never use it in our professional work. We never, you know, we can't verify it. And what's weirder is nobody else on the professional sector, military or civilian, has come out against them. You'd think once the Navy missile instructor
that's a big question. I'm going to interject there.
Yeah.
If people are so anti this, if there's, you know, NASA's trying to block people from going there, then why are they not trying to stop you from talking about it and spreading it?
That is the big question. The first obvious one where, you know, conspiracy.
Have any men in black been to your house?
No, I have not gotten suits and sunglasses at my door, either offering the gun or the money. I've been waiting for kind of like that one day, because I joke about it. It's like, because they offer it to you both at the same time. You take the money or you take the gun. You had to make your choice, like they did with Joe Rogan, but I don't want to pick on him. But with the whole moon thing. But with this, you're absolutely right. That's the big question. The first thing people will say, well, it's because Mark's obviously a government agent himself, and he's part of the problem. I was like, all right, fine. I get that. Conspiracy people are going to say that, and I'm not going to be a hypocrite. I'm going to say, you know, I'm not excluded from being under suspicion. Fine. You want to be suspicious of me? That's fine. But the other side is, maybe they're not talking to me because maybe the natural process, maybe they want this thing to come out. And that is, again, if it's a chess game, it's part of a bigger picture, which is, you talk about Flat Earth. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, that's the ultimate question here, I guess, to end out the show, is why is this being hidden? Why do we not? Why cover this whole thing?
Oh, you mean why cover it up in the first place?
Well, yeah, and before we get to that, just to boost on top of your point of what you just said, Mark.
Yeah.
It's interesting because we talk about on this show, and a lot of other shows talk about this too.
Yeah.
It's that there's so many shows in Hollywood, X-Files, whatever it might be, that talk about aliens and bring them out. Yeah. And people say it's because they're trying to get everybody ready for when the day actually comes where they disclose everything so people don't freak out because they're already used to this idea.
Like so the Vatican admitting that aliens exist, for example.
So do you think that something like the Truman Show – I mean, I love the Truman Show. I was younger when I saw it. I was late in high school, I think, junior year or something like that. The movie came out, and I cried because it was very emotional.
It's a great movie.
But it touched me, I was like, man, this – I felt very connected to that. I'm not saying I believe Flat Earth or I don't, but I did feel very connected to that to that movie, and I think a lot of people did. It was a turning point for Roger Ebert. I remember he said that he took back all the bad things he said about Jim Carrey after watching this movie.
Yeah.
Like, there was a lot of stuff that happened with that. That's the only movie I could think about that has sort of a flat earth connotation that's so blunt and obvious about it.
Yeah.
But so getting now back to Art's question is why hide it?
If you're the powers that be, and by that, why would you hide it in 1956 and keep it hidden? Because
only keep it hidden, mind you, but also go through extreme amounts of dollars and manpower and all sorts of other cover-ups in order to keep this hidden and to go to great lengths to make sure that people don't suspect it any other way or otherwise. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do.
NASA's budget is astronomical, not to mention things like the secret space program, which we have even had a chance to
do. Which I'm going to argue with Richard Hoagland tonight sometime after the show about, because unfortunately his secret space.
So let's tell everybody about that.
I can't remember. It's on I can't remember what the name of Dark 30 Radio. It's going to be at 9 p.m. Pacific time. Richard Hoagland and I and David Weiss and a fourth guy, and I can't remember his name, Italian-sounding name, Mike. He's a MUFON photographer.
Mario.
Could be.
Most Italian name I can
come. Anyway, let me answer the question of why, though, because this is important, because people were like, why would you cover it up? Why would they spend the money? And that is, think of the mess. The short answer is it would cause a big, big mess. And that is, first thing, all the education system, everything from high school up through your PhD programs. If you have an astrology or an astrophysics department, they're gone automatically. And then whatever the physical sciences remaining, biology, hydrology, archaeology, geology, those have to be completely retooled. And that's every textbook in every place in the world.
Oh my God, I didn't even think about the dinosaurs. How did the dinosaurs die?
Oh, they were probably a previous version of this place that was wiped out. Was it millions of years ago?
But can asteroids actually hit the Earth?
Oh yeah, yeah. Asteroids are just part of the process. I mean, that's just that's just a piece of metal ore thrown at speed. Maybe a rail gun. Friction does the rest. Don't aim at any big cities, which is why that one in Russia was kind of a dicey thing. But anyway, the second thing would be all the major religions of the world, the five big ones, Judaism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, and Christianity. They'd all get their holy grail, their handprint of God, proof of intelligent design, right then and there. They'd all get it simultaneously. And if you don't think there'd be a backlash against science, I'd hope they would take the high road on that, but science would take a big punch in the face.
The religions wouldn't, but the people of the religions would.
It could get ugly.
See extremism to a whole new level. You're right. It would rip the fabric of society apart in such a way that things would never be the same again. It would almost be an extinction level event.
Potentially. I mean, at one point religion would say, well, we knew this all along, and then the weird questions come up. It's like, well, if science was wrong about this, what else are they wrong about? Hey, religion, you were right about this. What else are you right about? It's like, oh, boy, we don't want to necessarily – well, anyway. And then the third thing is, the last thing and really the most important thing is, which is why I think it still is a message of hope, which is why it's resonating so well out there, is because you now have potentially a parental figure that's been looking over your shoulder your entire life. And if you know that to be sure. I mean, everybody knows what, you know, what right and wrong is, and you're not supposed to do this and that, but you're not
that's
sure.
That's what they say when we started messing with the atomic weapons. That's when the UFOs started showing up, because they were like, whoa, 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 whoa. You guys aren't supposed to be doing this yet. How are you here? But you're not,
exactly.
Like, this far along, we need to cut the bullshit. We all got to stop here for a second, and we're going to defuse the entire situation. And that's what a lot of people speculate.
Yeah.
Why they started showing up is because we figured out how to harness the atomic energy.
There you go.
Yeah, probably a little bit too prematurely, considering like our maturity level is.
We aren't exactly. Well, I mean, I think we do. I think the human civilization has got some very, very noble properties, but only if we have a common goal. If we have a common thing, that Reagan speech in 87, 88, where at the UN, where he was saying, would we go to war anymore if there was an external threat? You know, we're really good when we have everybody's focused on one thing, but if we don't have that, we just turn on each other immediately. And that's what I think this would be, is okay, finally, it's like, hey, by the way, you're all in the same boat. You're all in the same system. You still going to go to war? You still going to do the bad things you ever wanted to do if you know there might be a scorecard on your life? Now, that scorecard may not be real, but it's the Santa Claus argument, which is naughty and nice list doesn't mean anything. But then, if you see Santa Claus in your living room eating cookies, that naughty and nice list, that takes on a whole new level. And you really going to do something naughty anymore? Probably not. Which is why I talked about the astronauts. That funny thing, again, Bart Sibrel, where he kind of stumbled upon it. When he goes right. and he has the astronauts, put your hand in the Bible real quick and swear that you went to the moon. And they wouldn't do it. And I was going, that bugged me for years, because that was back in 2004. And I was going, Why are they not doing this? Are they strong Christians? Are they Boy Scouts? What's the problem? It's not that. It had nothing to do with the Bible. It's they're swearing.
I always thought it was just pride. You know, he had another thing that he said. One of his big things was that when the astronauts were giving the press conference at the end, yeah. none of them seemed happy.
Oh.
And they all seemed really just like upset.
Yeah.
And he thinks it's because that they were lying and not saying anything. But I said, you know, you never know what was going on behind the scenes. It doesn't have to be
I don't think they were just lying. I think it was much bigger than that. I think we do learn from our mistakes when it comes to the powers that be. And that was, I think, not only did the Apollo astronauts, did they fake everything, but they were told why. It's like, okay, just so you know, you're not going up there because you can't go up there. Because if we sent you up there, you know, I firmly believe no astronauts have been on the top of any rocket, because if they went up there, they would die. Oh, again, let's do a little sidebar thing. Want to have interesting thought. It's like, okay, what happened when the Challenger blew up in 1986? It's like, really? Look up on that, what's happened in the last year. Look up just any search engine. Type in Challenger astronauts still alive and click on the pictures. They found 6 of the 7. They're still out there. And 2 of them claim to be twin brothers of the guys that died in 1986.
Oh, I had no idea about that one. I'll have to check that one.
Because
still alive.
Which leads into what I was saying, which is,
whoa,
exactly.
Wow.
Which is the last thing you would want to do if you're doing a fake space program is put any astronauts on the top of a big pile of liquid explosives and then light a match to it. Because if something goes wrong, you're going to lose those guys. The problem is, if something does go wrong, well, what do you do with these guys? Do you a Capricorn 1 scenario where it's like, oh, we better kill them? Or do you just, you know, they put in their service, their military people, maybe, and put them in relocation? And, you know, at that point, they're indebted to you, which is what they've been doing. And, by the way, does that mean that every astronaut knows what's going on? No, I do not think so. Because everybody that's been doing the whole ISS crap that's going on up there, anyone wants to look that up, just type in ISS hoax into YouTube. You'll find some great stuff. Those are just Air Force employees, and they're just signing a disclosure agreement, and they don't have clearance to know anything higher. That keeps their mood in check. Apollo astronauts, they just crawled into bottles and hid behind their drapes in their houses. They never came out. Whereas everyone else now that's floating around there, oh, they couldn't be happier in their Dockers and their polo shirts and their socks, flying around the inside of this thing, never in a space suit, never doing any maintenance, never doing anything. They're just, I could go on.
I just threw a picture up in the chat room, by the way, of the supposedly still alive Challenger. There's side by side photos of the each astronaut next to the original photo that they took together 30 years ago, and it's pretty wild.
Yeah, some of these guys have really unique.
Room, someone just brought up a good point.
Yeah.
What about Edgar Mitchell?
Because I thought
Edgar
about
Mitchell
that too,
always says you know, that he did go there and explains what he saw and that he saw UFO craft. And
oh, yeah.
That.
Good stories, by the way, because remember everything I will give NASA credit for this, even though I critique their work a lot. And that is every story they have ever released about alien things, no matter what it is. It's the subtext, which you have to pay attention to. And that is, oh, there's a face on Mars. Is it real or not? It doesn't matter because you're thinking about it from a globe. Hey, that hexagon on the top of Saturn. Doesn't matter. Globe. Oh, there's a high-res picture of Pluto. Globe. Back and forth. Does not matter what the story is outside. All that matters is that you're looking at it, and once you give it thought, it reinforces the globe model that you're on. That's all they care about, is reinforcing the globe model so that you don't look outside of the globe model.
And by the way, why do we all grow up, and this is just the final thought I want to leave everyone with, why do we all grow up with model globes in our classrooms and in our homes? Because I had one in every classroom growing up, and I had one in every home growing up. It seems like this is something they get you with as early on as they can. It's ingrained deep.
Yep.
You know?
Yep.
So when something like
that
BOB,
way, that,
so when something
way
like BOB does happen, we all go, shut the fuck up, BOB. What are you talking about? I mean, that's
exactly.
And ultimately that's the goal, if I'm not mistaken. Mark, you've mentioned your clues and your videos and all sorts of things many times over the course of this program. Where can people go to watch all of your videos and read all your clues, or vice versa?
Okay, if they want to go to the website, it is enclosedworld.com. If they want to go to YouTube, it's just Mark K. Sargent, S-A-R-G-E-N-T. But really, the easiest way to find anything is just go into any search engine and type in Flat Earth Clues, and you will find it.
Flat Earth Clues at Google, or what? Give me the website one more time.
Enclosedworld.com.
Enclosedworld.com. And are you on social media? Can people follow you on Twitter?
No, I am not on Twitter or Facebook. I am stretched too thin as it is. So, best my email address, I'll throw that out there real quick. Email address is msargent23@comcast.net.
And I'm sure that is on your website as well.
It is, yeah. And my phone number.
Great. Okay, so if you'd like to get in touch with Mark, just go to his website. Easy enough. Done and done. Hey, we really, really do appreciate you coming on the show. This has been a fun one. These shows that fly by in 90 minutes, but they feel like they're five, are always my favorite, and you've accomplished that, my friend.
Well, thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much.
We'd love to have you on in the future. I know there's going to be some more news that comes out. Anything that happens with Flat Earth, if you...
Yeah.
Enjoyed yourself today, please, 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 we'd love to have you back on the program.
I would be happy to come back.
And where can and you mentioned for everyone listening live, mm-hmm. where on earth are you going to be arguing with Richard Hoagland? Just for my own, I'm going to tune into that.
It's going to be on Dark 30 Radio tonight.
Dark 30. So just search Dark 30 Radio, and that starts at what time?
It starts at 9 p.m. Pacific. But I'll post it later on YouTube as well, so you don't have to stay up early.
So you can find it on YouTube as well. Great.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, Mark. We really appreciate it. And as Mark Schwartz said, we would love to have you back on at some point.
Cool.
And I'm rushing because we're already over on the clock. So, Mark Schwartz, if there's anything else that you would like to add, do it now because
that's it. Go ahead and email us. Let us know what you thought. We can pass your thoughts along, discuss them next week on our show, truthfunders@gmail.com. And we have a doozy for you next week. So tune in. We will be talking Hollywood. We will be talking UFOs, and we will be combining the two.
truthfunders@gmail.com, truthfunders@gmail.com is the email address. And since MJ charges us $1,000 for every minute we go over on the program, I'm just going to end it now. Goodbye from Truth Funders Radio. We'll talk to you next week.
Adios.
You only owe me $667.
Come and get it. Come and get it, motherfucker.
You notice I didn't say three sixes.
Yeah, I noticed how you deliberately didn't do that.
Awesome. Hey, Mark, really, thank you so much.
No, thank you.
For coming on.
I'm totally.